Right, good stuff. Well, if we can kick the lights up in here, we'll get some stuff rolling. It's testimony time. Hopefully you're awake, you're ready, you're present. And so I'm going to kick off the testimony time. Let me sort of give you an outlook of the service. I'm going to give a little testimony about God's fingerprints and how that's been working over some exciting things in the church over the last several months. And then we're going to have a little more singing. Then our Ethiopia missions team is going to come up, and they're going to have some testimony time about the trip that you sent them on and you prayed for them while they were there, and some of the wonders of God that they saw and what God taught them. And then I think we have one more song, and then all of you are going to have a chance to be able to share some testimony about what God has been teaching you, either in your life or through the series that we've just wrapped up, our Stop Talking, Start Doing series. And so this is one of my favorite Sundays ever, is when we get to hear what God is doing from all of you and not just from me talking forever. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and start into this testimony time so that we can hear everybody else's testimonies. But for those of you that missed last Sunday, you missed an awesome time of worship outside. It was perfect weather. It was really kind of neat, wasn't it? Just to be out there worshiping the Lord together and eating together and doing the prayer walk thing. It was neat to see all of your Facebook pictures. And there was a big announcement last week, a big announcement that the elders have been praying and seeking the Lord, and we really felt like the Lord has led us to a potential piece of property that would be our new church home for the next 75 years. And so I sent an email about that. Hopefully you saw that. We're really excited about that. And so I just want to share with you God's fingerprints of how all this came about. And then give you a timeline of what we're going to do, of how we're going to pray, and when you guys are going to vote, and when we're going to go out on the land and pray together, and all that sort of stuff, so that we can all unite as one big family in this big decision. And so before we do that, before I share the testimony of how it all came about, I want to tell you why I feel like God is choosing now to do what He's doing. Because we've been a church for 8 years now. That's hard to believe. 8 years. And so the beginning of the month in October, it was 8 years that Katie and I came up to Mooresville. And some of you guys came about 6 months before that to Mooresville to start the church. And so it's been 8 years. And we rent this building, and it's been a great building for us. This was a move of God. For those of you that weren't here for that period of time, an anonymous donor gave a $100,000 gift so that we could move into a place outside of the school. We could have a more permanent presence in the community. And man, we went through this place and it was terrible when we got here, and we remodeled this whole place. We gutted everything. We worked together as a big team. I mean, it was amazing what happened in this place and how God worked all of the God-sized things out just for us to be able to be here. That was incredible. And we've been here about 5 years now. And so I think the question is, why now? What is the Lord doing now? Why is He choosing to do that now? So I was riding home from church last Sunday outside. I had my windows down, man. My hands were out the window just cruising home in the truck, and I had some think time with the Lord. And as I was thinking, I was praying about the land and praying about talking to everybody about it, and the Lord put this phrase in my mind, and I've never heard this phrase anywhere before. I even researched the internet, and I was like, did I steal that from somebody? Like, did I hear that on the radio? Is that like James McDonald's thing? Like, am I encroaching on copyright stuff or whatever? But it was truly just a Holy Spirit moment, and I was thinking about the land and thinking about all this and why, Lord, this is just so great and we're excited about this. And Lord, what is this all about? And this is what the Holy Spirit said to me. He said, when you're thinking about the land, this is the phrase that you need to think about. This is why I'm doing what I'm doing. This is the whole goal of the land. And it's this phrase right here: a broad place for an open door. Everybody say that with me. A broad place for an open door. I love this image of a broad place. Instantly, the Holy Spirit took my mind back to the Psalms where David talks about how the Lord took him out of the miry clay and He set his feet on the rock. Psalm 19 says this word, Psalm 18 verse 19, He says, He brought me out into a broad place. He rescued me because He delighted in me. And so I'm thinking, Lord, why are You choosing to do this? Because when you hear the story, I mean, this is a God-sized thing. Like, Lord, there's lots of churches in the area that could have used this particular land. There's lots of churches that would have been great there. Lord, why are You choosing to do this for us? And I really feel like the Lord is just saying, I'm just choosing to delight in you guys. I'm just choosing to show you my delight. No, well, why would God choose to do that? And then this where the second phrase really came into my mind. It was for an open door. Now, how many of you remember back when we did the Revelation series, Jesus' letters to the church, right? Do you remember what church we talked about that had the open door? It was the Church of Brotherly Love, our city of brotherly love, Church of Philadelphia, right? You know, and here was what Jesus said to the church in Philadelphia. Revelation 3 verse 8 says, "I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door that nobody is able to shut. I know you have but little power, but you've kept my word and you haven't denied my name." And when we were going through that series, that was one of the things we prayed about. Lord, help us not be like these other six churches that we read about. Lord, help us be like the church in Philadelphia, where it's not built on any one of us. It's not built on our own abilities or what we're great at. But Lord, I pray that you would set before us an open door that only can be explained by you doing it. That when people would look at the things going on in our church and through our church and around our church, they would be like, man, they're not that smart to pull that off. They're not that good. They're not that they don't have that many people to be able to do that stuff. Man, that has to be only explained by God, like opening the door and he just has his hand on it where nobody can shut it. That we can't mess it up. That it's just him opening the door for wide open ministry in the community. So I'm thinking about this almost 17 acres of land a mile from us. And that was what the Holy Spirit put in my mind, that he's giving us a broad place so he can set an open door for ministry that nobody can shut. Isn't that cool? So let's say that one last time. A broad place for an open door. All right, so let me give you the backstory. I'm going to give you a quick history. I could stand up here and talk too long, and you guys would be bored with that. But I want to share with you just really quickly the fingerprints of God, some of the big highlights that have happened since July, okay? And so the elders had looked at a couple of different properties, and they had three things in common, all the ones we looked at. It was either the wrong location, the wrong price, or the wrong size and shape. Right next door to the church here, there's 13 acres of land that's for sale, and it was a great price. But you couldn't build a single wide module on it because it's turned like a Coke bottle, and so there's no way we could ever do everything God called us to do. There's not enough space. There's another piece of property that's right down the road here. It's 16 acres, and it's a beautiful piece of property, but it was totally the wrong price because there's no way that we would be able to afford that place. And so I told you last Sunday, this new thing, this new place that the Lord has brought to us, we weren't really seeking it out. It was something the Lord did, and it fits all three of those things. It's 1 mile from the church. It's a great price. We can be able to pay cash for it in 9 months. I really believe the Lord is going to do that. And it's the right size. There's almost 17 acres of land. We can do everything that the Lord has called us to do to really reach the community for Jesus. And so let me give you the quick backstory, all right? Here we go. So on Monday, July 14th, I feel like I'm in like a 48 hours episode, right? You know, it's like Monday, July 14th, 4 p.m. No, here's what happened. Jason Slager, one of our elders, he had been tasked with going to the bank and finding out what the process would be for a church to be able to get a loan or to be able to build or to be able to buy land. We just didn't know. And so we'd taken all of our financials over to the bank to see what kind of position we were in as a church. And they were like, "You're in a stellar position." We were like, "That's good to know. That's important." And so he went to the bank on that Monday. Well, at the same time, Pastor Byron Wicker from River Life Fellowship Church, right down the road from us, he went to the bank that Monday. Now, he went to the bank for a totally different reason. That bank owns the note on their land that they have over off Shenville Road. And so he was going to the bank to ask the bank manager, "Hey, what do you think we should do with this land that we have? We don't feel like we're going to be there long term. We don't feel like the Lord has led us to build out there anymore. So what should we do before we sell it?" And so the bank manager put two and two together, since both of them were there on the same day, and said, "Hey, Jason, you need to call this guy." So Jason emails me on Monday, said, "Hey, I know it's your day off. Listen, don't call me back today. Call me back on Tuesday." So I wake up the next day. I call Jason on Tuesday. You can go to that next one. On Tuesday morning, I call Jason. He's like, "Oh, listen, there's this church and they have this land. I don't know if you know the pastor or not." And I'm like, "I know Byron. We're good friends. We've known each other for a really long time. I'll give him a call." And so I call Pastor Byron and I say, "Tell me a little bit about this situation. Tell me a little bit about this land." He starts to describe it, and like I'm driving, and I'm thinking, this is just too good to be true. This is perfect. It's less than a mile from us, and the only thing was I didn't know what it cost, right? It's like big enough. It's the right location, and so I'm starting to get a little nervous, and you know, I talk to him, and you get those butterflies in your stomach. You get this excitement, and so I'm kind of talking to him. He said, "David, listen, we're not going to use this land anymore. As far as I'm concerned, it's time for us to be done with it." And he said, "I know you guys. Our people know you guys. He said, we know what you're doing in the community. We really believe in the vision of Christ community. We want to partner with you guys in that. He said, if it was up to me, I really would just sign the land over to you. And he said, but unfortunately, we're not in a financial position to be able to do that because we still owe money on the property. And I said, well, nobody's asking you to give it, but if you want to. But nobody's asking you to give it, but like I would love for you to consider us, because they had not even listed the land for sale yet. They were just in the preliminary phases. And he said, how about this? I have an elders meeting scheduled for tonight to talk about this land. And so why don't I talk to them about your church? I'll call you back tomorrow. And so he called me back and says, I talked to all of my elders. They love you guys too. A lot of them knew you. A lot of them knew your people. And so they think this is a great idea. We should see what we could do to move forward. And so on Tuesday, I'm making phone calls. So I'm calling all of our elders, and I start to talk to all of our elders. Hey, guys, this is something we should fast and pray about. Like, this is something that's not like all these other pieces of land that we've viewed. This is something different. This sounds really cool. And so I call Doug Waldo on the phone, and he's one of our elders, and I get into mid-sentence. Hey, there's a piece of property off of Shenville Road that you should pray about. And he stops, and he says, are you talking about the land that River Life owns over off Shenville Road? And I said, yeah. He said, Dave, you are not going to believe this. This is the craziest thing that has happened that you're telling me this right now. He says, last Friday, this was on Tuesday, right? Last Friday, he said, I have one of their former elders, a great leader in their church. He's been working for me for over a month now. And he said, I was in a conversation with him. And he said, Dave, it's so weird that you're saying this, because I totally felt from the Holy Spirit I was supposed to ask that guy about their land. He said, I knew that they were planning on building a school there one day, and they were going to have their church there one day, and now they didn't have a school, and they were satisfied where they were. And so I just asked the guy last Friday, hey, what are you guys doing with that land? And he said, their guy told me, hey, you know Byron, Doug, you should just call him. You should talk to him about it. So this is like 4 days before Byron even goes to the bank. And so I'm thinking, wow, that is like so cool. I'm getting goosebumps about this deal, man. This is really kind of crazy. And so I hang up the phone, call the rest of the elders, and tell them about Doug's deal. And man, he's already asking about the land before anybody even pursued anything with the land. This is really kind of a cool situation. And so I'm driving down to Summit Coffee Shop, and I'm just praying. And I'm like, Lord, this is a scary step as a church, you know, because we're kind of comfortable right now, like we're uncomfortably comfortable, you know what I mean? Like, you know, we can be here, but this building has its limitations. We know we can't do everything you've called us to do here forever. And so I'm just kind of praying as I'm driving through, and I really heard the Lord say to me, as clear as anything that I've heard him say, he said, I've already given you guys this land. And I thought, Lord, that is a scary thing for me to say that you've said. And so I totally just kept that to myself. And so I go home that night, and Katie and I are laying down in bed, and I remember this conversation. It was totally while I was prepping the series on Stop Talking, Start Listening. And it was, how do you hear God's voice through all these different circumstances or whatever? And so I'm talking to Katie, and I said, honey, God told me something today about this land, but I'm not going to tell anybody about it. And she was like, well, what did he tell you? And I said, well, I was literally driving down, and I'm praying about this land, and I really felt like the Holy Spirit said, I've already given this to you guys. And I'm like, I don't know what that means. I don't know anything about it, but I'm not going to tell anybody about it. And she said, why? And I said, well, what if I was wrong? Like, or what if I misheard? Like, what if it was a chili dog or something? You know what? What happens if it's like, you know, a feel or whatever? What if it wasn't the Holy Spirit? And she said, babe, you hear God's voice as clearly about lots of things. Like, he tells you what to read. You listen to him about what to preach. Like, why would you be worried about that? I was like, okay, I guess you're right. And so the next morning on Wednesday, I woke up and I was getting ready to have my quiet time, and the Lord told me, go to John chapter 4. And in my mind, I'm like, woman at the well? Why am I going to woman at the well? What are you trying to teach me with this? And the Holy Spirit is like, no, further down. And so I read further down, and it's a story of the official who comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, you've got to come with me and heal my son. And Jesus looks at him, and you know what he says back? Look right here. He says, this generation, unless you just keep seeing signs and wonders, you won't believe, will you? I'm like, okay, Lord, or is that for me? You know, and so then I keep on reading. And then the guy says, no, Jesus, you've got to come back. You've got to heal my son. Come on, come on, come on. And Jesus looks at him and he says, your son is already healed. Go your way. And it says the man did this. It says the man believed God and he went on his way. And I felt like the Holy Spirit kind of convicted, like, are you going to believe me or not? And so I'm like, okay, Lord, I believe you. I believe you. And so then later the man goes and right before he gets back to where his son is, the servant comes out and says, sir, your son, he's better. And then there's something really cool in the scripture. You look at John chapter 4 today. The man looks at his servant and he says, when was it? When was the first hour that the boy started to get well? He says this last little phrase, and this is the important part. It says, because he knew that it was the moment that Jesus had spoken. Right? And so then the man answers him and he celebrates. And here's what the Holy Spirit told me with that. He said, listen, he asked not for confirmation. He wasn't, hey, when was it that the boy started to get better? Oh, it was the exact moment that Jesus said it. Oh, man, that's a relief. Right? Like, that wasn't the way. He asked not for confirmation. He asked out of celebration because he was like, so when did it happen? Right? When did it happen? Oh, when Jesus said, yeah, see, that's the exact time because I knew it and I wanted you to know so we could celebrate. And so as I'm sort of journaling things down and talking to the Lord said, listen, as you present this to elders, as you present this to the church, I just want you to say this. Listen, I'm going to speak to them the same way that I've spoken to you. And when you hear that I've spoken to them, it's not going to be out of confirmation because I've already confirmed it and you've chosen to believe it. It's going to be as an opportunity for celebration. And so I was excited and really nervous all at the same time. And so the next day I go and I met with Byron on the land and I heard some of his story. And so we're there and he says, David, listen, I just got back from a mission trip. While I was on the mission trip, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, there's three things that we need to take care of as a church before we move forward. Since I've been back, the first two are off the list. The third one is this land. And he said, I really feel like this is God working these things out because he said, let me tell you what I did. He said, I got back from my mission trip. I called all of the elders and told them we were going to have a meeting on Tuesday. We were going to have a meeting on Tuesday, but I didn't tell any of them what it was about. All I said was that we have some new directions of things that I feel like the Lord is leading us to do. I want us to meet on Tuesday and talk about it. And so he said, then on Saturday night, the craziest thing happened. One of my guys, a key leader in my church, we were at a party, and he came up to me and he said, hey, I started working for this guy, Doug Waldo, and he was asking me today about this land that we have. What are we going to do with that land? Would you guys be interested in selling it to him? And one of Byron's elders said that he hasn't told anybody about the land. He hasn't told anybody that that's one of the things the Lord wanted him to work through. And so then one of his elders is sitting there. He said, hey, is that why we're meeting on Tuesday? And Byron said, well, as a matter of fact, it is. We're meeting on Tuesday to talk about the land. And then he went on Monday to the bank, and then I called him on Tuesday afternoon, and they already had the elders meeting scheduled to talk about it. So we meet at the land. Now, let me show you a little overview of the land. Here we go. I'm taking way too long, but it's exciting. Okay, this is on Shenville Road. And so, as you can tell, there's 2.79 acres at the very front piece, and then it's attached to 14 acres in the back, all right? And so if you look, that neighborhood that's right beside it on two sides is Pecan Hills Subdivision. And so it's literally just a few hundred feet after you turn off of Statesville Highway. And so you can almost see Statesville Highway from the entrance. And so there's a 2.7 acre deal. Now here's an aerial shot of it from Google Earth. All right, so you can see sort of what the pattern is. This 2.7 acres, it's all field, and then there's a mobile home that's on that. And then the 14 acres is fully wooded. I mean, it's just a beautiful wooded lot, all right? And so the elders have been praying. The elders have gotten together. And so we had been fasting. We've been praying about this deal, but we still don't know the price. We still don't know anything about it. But we start to dream a little bit. Lord, what could you do with this? Because it's sort of like, how would you work this out? And so we're like, well, we could put like a little drive down to get to the land. And then What could you put up front so that people would be able to see and know and be visible in the community? And we're like, well, you know, you could put like sports fields. You could do sports fields right there. There's already water and sewer. You could do like a cool picnic shelter, something like that, like we met at last week. You could put parking right there, and then you zoom out, and then you just build on the 14 acres of land that's wooded. And so you could do everything the Lord has called us to do. So we get together, we're like dreaming, and we're excited, and we're praying, and we're fasting, but we still don't know anything about what the land costs. And so the elders directed me, find out. And so so the next step was to meet with Byron. So I met with Byron and I started talking to him, and I was really nervous, and I was just like, you know, I don't know how to go about this. We can't make an offer on the land and lowball offer you because you haven't even listed it with a realtor yet. And so the next step was I just had lunch with him and I talked with him and I told him everything that we've been praying about and fasting about. You can go to that next slide. And so here's what happened. 2 weeks later, oh, you can look at some pictures. Never mind. We'll just do that. Okay, this is a picture looking across the street. You can see sort of the big field, and on the left-hand side, that's where a drive would be. As you go further down into it, this is sort of the field area, some great pecan trees. This is at the edge of the property. On the left-hand side, you see the houses from Pecan Hills Subdivision. And then there's like a 100-foot driveway that extends into where the trees would be. That would be where we would have a driveway towards where we would build something in the future whenever the Lord tells us to do that, if He leads that way. And then this is what it looks like for the other 14 acres. It's just beautiful tree lots, some beautiful hardwoods on there. That's what it is. So we get together, Byron and I talk, and I'm like, man, I just don't know what to say. What were you guys thinking of listing it for? And here was the other part that God sort of shocked and surprised me with. He said, David, listen, here's the deal. We bought this front 2.7 acres. We bought that. But the other 14 acres was a gift. And it came as a gift from somebody with a stipulation that we can never ever sell it just for us. That whatever goes on this land, it always has to be used for the kingdom of God. And so he said that was the stipulation with the gift. That it always had to be used for some purpose forever and ever for the kingdom of God. And he says, I already talked to the guy that gave us that 14 acres and I've told him about your church. And he says, it would be amazing if you guys did that. Built a church there. So he said, but here's the problem. We bought at the height of the market. And so we bought this little piece of property, this 2.7 acre, because we were landlocked. We had this 14 acres, but we had no way to get to it. And so we bought this 2.7 acres to connect to it. And so here we are. And he said, we've had to do all kinds of stuff. Like we've had to put a new roof on the house, and the well dried up. And so we had to annex that 2.7 acres. And that was an expense. And we had to get on city water and sewer there, because that part is on city water and sewer, but the 14 acres is not, which that's a huge deal to have water and sewer access right there. That's another big deal. Anyway, I'm going too long. And so he said, here's the thing. We've got, you know, this money into it. And he said, but here's what I feel like. I really feel like this is a God thing. And he said, we're kingdom people. And he said, you know, we could ask whatever we wanted to ask for it. There's not like a restriction on us selling the land. And we could have him ask like what, you know, we paid for it or whatever. But he said, here's what I'm thinking. This seems like a God thing. His fingerprints are all over it. And so if you guys just pay what we owe on the land for that 2.7 acres, then all the land is yours. And I was like, wow. So the next question was, how much do you owe? and he told me, he said, we owe $225,000 on it. And so he said, if your church feels like this is what the Lord wants, then you guys can have all 17 acres for $225. You just pay off what we owe on that 2.7, and it's yours. Now, I don't know if you bought land lately, but $13,000 an acre in Mooresville is the best deal you're ever going to find anywhere, right? It has access to water sewer. It can be annexed. That 14 acres can be annexed, and then you don't have to worry about any building restrictions for the floodplain or any of that stuff. And so I was blown away, man. I was in tears. I went across the street to the coffee shop, and I called some of the elders. I'm talking to them, and I'm just like boo-hooing on the phone, you know, and I'm like typing stuff out so I remember it, because I wanted to remember that day. And so now here's the deal. So after all this stuff, we took all that to the elders, and then for 2 months they fasted and prayed about it. That's how seriously they took, even with all these fingerprints of the Lord, there were questions that they had, and they wanted to fast and pray and get questions answered. And so for 2 months, they fasted and prayed. And then just a few weeks ago, you can go to the next slide, the elders had unity. Now, that's a big deal for 10 elders, I want to tell you. And so for 10 elders to say, yes, with all of our different personalities, with all of our different views about money and how money should be spent and what good uses are for the kingdom and what not so good uses are for the kingdom, to have 10 people say, God's either spoken to us or we trust that God's spoken to these other guys and we're fully on board. And so we had a complete unity on Friday. So then the next step was to meet and talk about our terms. And this is where we got a little worried, because we don't have $225,000 laying around. Right? Do you have, if anybody does, it would be a great time to let us know. All right? So you just, we can repass the plate. It'd be a great day. Like, we'll just leave here. I'll call Byron on the way out. It'd be fantastic. But no, listen, we didn't, so we were kind of worried about that. And so we had this idea and we're kind of scared about it. And so we talked to them about it and they agreed to every single one of our terms. It was amazing. They didn't ask for anything back. They just said, this is a win for the kingdom. We believe God's leading you guys to do this. We're excited. And so the next week, we got a signed contract pending vote of approval. Now, here's what the contract says. It says that we give them almost nothing. I think it was $1,000 of earnest money or due diligence money. And then we have 9 months to do everything that we need to do as a church without paying them a thing. We have 9 months to pursue zoning changes so that we can get annexation for that back 14 acres. We have 9 months to get a site plan, a building plan for the future, not right away, but for the future. We have 9 months to do all the tests and the permit process, all these other things. We have 9 months to raise $225,000, and they're not asking for anything. And if at any point during that 9 months we find out, well, you can't ever build a church here, we can just walk away, and it only costs us that $1,000. Isn't that incredible? And so they agreed to every single thing. So let me give you the outline of where we're moving forward. This Tuesday, I'm taking way too long, I'm sorry. All right, this Tuesday, there's going to be a day of fasting and prayer. And here's what I want you to pray. Lord, confirm for me, so we can all celebrate. Say, confirm for me, so we can all celebrate. The elders have confirmed and fasted, all of us. Confirm for me, so we can all celebrate. So that's going to be Tuesday. On Wednesday, before the time changes, I wanted a chance for you to go out and see the land before it's dark at 4 p.m., right? I hate that. All right, so this Wednesday at 6 p.m., we're going to visit and pray on the land, all right? So if you don't have, if you don't receive emails from the church, you need to fill out your response card, put your email address, because we're emailing out directions to the church. And we can actually meet here. If you don't know where it is, 5:45, we can meet here, and then we'll just drive over, okay? But at 6 o'clock, we're going to visit on the land. We're going to dream a little bit together. We're going to walk through the woods and sing Kumbaya. It's going to be amazing, right? Now, on November 2nd, part of the service is going to be talking about the campaign that we're going to do. How are we going to raise $225,000? And I really believe with all of my heart, in less than 9 months, it'll all be there. I really believe the Lord will do that. And then we'll also visit next Sunday for those who can't be here Wednesday. Next Sunday on November 2nd, 4 p.m. we'll be out there as well before it gets dark, since it'll get dark at 5. And so we'll be there at 4 p.m. There'll be some question and answer time that you can ask. And then November 9th, on that Sunday, we'll vote as a church as to the future of what the Lord wants us to do. All right? So that's the testimony of what the Lord has been doing. But here's why He's doing it. Go back to that first slide, Rick. He's given us a broad place for an open door. If we just have a building, a great gym that can be used all the time and whatever, if we just have land so we can say, "Woo, look at us, we're like every other church," that is pointless, isn't it? He's given us a broad place so we can have an open door for ministry to this community, so we can accomplish the vision that He's called us to do. This is not the vision. This is not the goal. This is a tool to get to the vision, right? The vision is an open door for ministry. And so I hope you're excited with me. Let's say it one last time. A broad place for an open door. Lord, I pray that You would bless these people, bless all of us as we sing together. Lord, I pray that You would bless this time of testimony from the missions team. Lord, I thank You for all You're doing and all You're going to do. I'm excited to see how You confirm and how we all celebrate. In Jesus' name.